Would the clerk please call the roll?
Benson.
Here.
Eckhart.
Here.
Hannaford.
Here.
Sherman.
Here.
Stelling.
Here.
Valencia.
Here. Do you have a quorum? Item number four, discussion and action on the consent agenda. All of the following items, which concern reports and items of a routine nature normally approved at city council meetings, will be approved by one vote of the council. Any member of the council desiring to discuss an item on the consent agenda may request that it be removed from the consent agenda and placed for discussion as the next item on the regular agenda. It will then be considered separately. The consent agenda consists of the consideration and action of the following items. A, approval of the minutes of the regular meeting of October 17th, 2016, and B, approval of claims in the amount, and please note the change here, $253,594.28, and payroll expenses of $146,994.11. Those numbers were transposed in item B. Do I have a motion to approve the consent agenda?
I'll make a motion to approve the consent agenda.
Second.
I have a motion from Councilman Benson and a second from Councilman Hannaford to approve the consent agenda. Is there any further discussion? Would the clerk please call the roll?
Benson?
Yes.
Hannaford?
Yes.
Stelling?
Yes.
Valencia?
Yes.
Sherman?
Yes.
Eckhart?
Yes.
We will move items 6 and 7 to later on in the agenda. We'll move to item number 8, which is reports from boards and officers. Report A is the Alva Tourism Tax Meeting on October 19th. Councilman Benson?
I missed that meeting, but they had one application for money from the OML League Leadership Class, and that was approved to give not to exceed $1,608. That's going to bring around 20 people to Alva to spend the night in our motels a couple nights and go to a leadership class. So they did make that approval.
Any questions for Councilman Benson? Okay, the report on the Alva Hospital Authority special meeting. Councilman Hannaford?
Pretty routine. Approved the CEO's report. Approved the reappointment of some courtesy staff, went over Poppy. Approved some new procedures and policies for the hospital. We did get, it was in the paper, we did have Carly Williams from BKD with the audit report. We did approve Dr. Yvonne Carmichael as a AHA representative on the Shared Medical Center Foundation Board of Trustees. And I will announce that it was Terry Klein, his last meeting as a board member for the Alva Hospital Board.
Are there any questions for Councilman Hannaford? Okay, item C, the Finance Committee report. Chairman Benson.
Well, we went over the claims and signed the claims and payroll. As usual, there were some large claims I thought I'd just go over. We had a $16,000 for audit, pretty close to $9,000 from street lighting. We had $15,500 for asphalt and chip and seal oil. We paid out $21,000 to the big cruise and car show, which was approved several months ago through the Tourism and Tax Committee. And we paid about $51,000 out in a taxiway project at the airport and almost $50,000 for the hangar project. And we visited a little bit about our, I just forgot what we want to call them, our time
keeping system.
Yeah. System. Our time system that we're looking at doing, and we're still in research and preliminary stages of that. Anybody have any questions, I'll try to answer.
Any questions for Chairman Benson? Anything you need to add to that?
I don't think there's anything I'd add at this time.
Okay. The mayor's report, the mayor will, is going to be delayed a little bit tonight, but he should be here a little bit later. With that, we'll move to the city business manager's report.
Well, there's just a few items I'd like to report on. One, our library improvements. We've had some contractors, if you haven't noticed, we've had some contractors working up at the library, repairing masonry work, and repairing the masonry on the outside of the library, and doing some caulking and replacing caulking around the windows. This, we believe, is going to, you know, just, it's just regular maintenance for our building, but it's stuff that hadn't been done in quite some time. And now I know that this might get sound a little different, but we have, we believe we have solved the pigeon problem at the library. There were some pigeons that were getting down into some ductwork. We got them flushed out. We got them cleaned out. We got the ductwork cleaned, netted over so that these inlets aren't allowing pigeons to get back into the, into the building. We are still working on issues of pigeons around the square. There are several different things, a couple of different viable options that we're looking at right now. One is a chemical that we can run through our fogger that will help disperse the, emits a odor that they don't like. It'll help disperse them. The other viable option that we have right now is propane cannons. These can be set in different areas, a couple of different areas around around the square. And every 10 or 30, it can be programmed from 10 to 30 minutes, just emit a loud boom that drives the pigeons away. Makes them uncomfortable. Hopefully they find a new place to roost. I am talking with, they're trying to get a hold of the USDA Animal Control Division to see what they may recommend is before we spend any kind of money on either one of those options. But that has been the research we've been able to find about our pigeon problem. There will be an upcoming resolution calling for a municipal election. This resolution has to be passed and filed at the Woods County Election Board prior to January 20th of 2017. It will be for the seats of city treasurer, ward 1, 2, 3, and 4, seats 1. And we'll have that resolution before the council in the near future. We did complete, and as Councilman Benson reported, pay for the repairs around South Share Airport hangar to allow for water to be drained away from the hangar. I'll need to see, I'll probably call them tomorrow and see how that has worked through this rain. They did complete that, and we've paid for that ramp. There is some additional ramp work that will need to be done, but we're looking at doing this at a time when maybe FAA will help fund part of the repair costs. We are meeting tomorrow morning, or I'm meeting tomorrow morning with a couple of the airport board members to evaluate the concrete foundation and ramp for the new T-hangers that are being constructed. We got four bidders, construction costs ranging anywhere from $94,000 to $179,000. We'll evaluate those bids and make a recommendation to the airport board a week from tonight. We are looking at trying to get some repairs done to the fencing out at the Alva Recreational Park East Soccer Field. High winds in the first part of September blew the north and south ends of the soccer field fencing over, or bent the poles. You know, we've been, up to now, we've been trying to get repair costs. Repair and replacement costs range anywhere right now from $10,900 to $22,000. Our insurance policy carries a $2,500 deductible. Right now, we're working with the insurance company on getting that replaced. There have been a couple of questions over the past few weeks about the corners of Young Street and Thunderbird Road and Young Street and Monroe. Where there's some little bit more asphalt work needing to be done. The city is working to replace that asphalt right now because of the temperature. It's not feasible for us to try to go to Woodward or Enid to get that asphalt and bring it in. But there is a company that's right outside of town, about 15 or 20 minutes, that's producing asphalt. And if they are producing asphalt on days that we can get it, and they're producing the type of asphalt that we need, we are able to buy from them and put that down. It looks like right now we may be able to get, they should be running sometime this week, and it won't take, you know, a day for us to get those finished once we get the asphalt. And if it's not done sometime this week, the next time they'll be running asphalt is probably mid-December. And as long as pavement temperatures are correct and the asphalt is being produced, we ought to be able to get that taken care of this calendar year. Right now, we are looking at still looking for a couple of paramedic and a couple of part-time full-time EMT basic. Police department has been going through interviews and are about the chief. The police chief is about ready to submit to me recommendations for a hire for open positions on the police department. We've got several meetings upcoming over the next couple of weeks. Airport board, board of adjustment, tourism, all coming up within the next, sometime between now and the next council meeting. We'll note that the city hall and city of Alva will be closed on November 11th in observance of Veterans Day. And I would be happy to answer any questions that the council may have over anything.
Are there any questions for Mr. Dunham? Okay, we'll move to item number 9, discussion and action on ordinance number 2016-001, an ordinance amending the employee retirement system defined contribution plan for eligible employees of the city of Alva, Oklahoma, providing for the definition of compensation pertaining to the plan design, providing for repealer and severability, and declaring an emergency. Joe Don.
This item has been discussed several times through the Personnel Committee and the Finance Committee. We had looked at it. This is a way for the city to be able to provide a better retirement program for the city, for the employees. The employees have been in and been through individual meetings with the retirement company about this program. Essentially, what we will do is take all of the money that we are contributing right now toward the employee's retirement program and put it into the defined contribution plan. It will be diverted to from the defined contribution to the defined benefit. The defined contribution plan will remain open, and anything above the minimum that the employee wishes to contribute will go into the defined contribution plan. And the employees will then direct OMRF on how they'd like their funds to be invested. This met with an overwhelming positive response from the employees, and it would benefit, no additional cost to the city. The employee would end up having to put in 1% more and it would be a 33% increase in their retirement benefits at retirement. But other than the changes in the way we're contributing money, there's no changes into what would happen for the employee. If the employee wished to take lump sum, I know that's been a question, that the employee is able to take lump sum. That lump sum payment, that just eliminates all future payments that the city would have to pay that employee and releases the city of its liability of retirement benefits for that employee. I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Are there questions for Mr. Dunham? I would ask for a motion.
Do these need to be two different motions?
Yes.
Make a motion to approve ordinance 2016-001.
Second.
What's that, Councilman Sherman? I have a motion from Councilman Hannaford and a second from Councilman Sherman to approve ordinance number 2016-001. Is there any further discussion? Would the clerk please call the roll?
Hannaford?
Yes.
Sherman?
Yes.
Stelling?
Yes.
Eckhart?
Yes.
Benson?
Yes.
Valencia?
Yes. Item 10, discussion and action on ordinance number 2016-002, an ordinance amending the employee retirement system defined benefit plan for the city of Alva, Oklahoma, pertaining to plan design, pertaining to plan options, providing for contributions by employees, providing for employer pickup of mandatory contributions, providing for repealer and severability, and declaring an emergency. Mr. Dunham.
The same commentary goes along with this one. This is the defined benefit. Again, the city's total contribution is going to be 6.74% of salary. The employee will start contributing 3%. They currently are mandated to contribute 2%. There are several that contribute more. But it is a plan level increase. And an increase of benefits for 33%. And upon passage of both the ordinance and the emergency, it'll go into effect on December 1. Did we pass the emergency on the other one? We might want to go back and do that.
We need to do that.
Yeah.
So we will go back to item 9, which is the declaring of emergency for ordinance number 2016-001.
I'll make a motion to declare an emergency on ordinance 2016-001.
I have a second.
Second.
A motion from Councilman Benson and a second from Councilman Hannaford. Declare an emergency for ordinance number 2016-001. Is there any additional discussion? Would the clerk please call the roll on that?
Benson?
Yes.
Hannaford?
Yes.
Eckhart?
Yes.
Stelling?
Yes.
Valencia?
Yes.
Sherman?
Yes.
Okay, moving back to item number 10. Joe Don, was that the conclusion of your report?
That was the conclusion of mine.
Are there any additional questions for Mr. Dunham? We entertain a motion to approve ordinance number 2016-002.
Make a motion to approve ordinance number 2016-002.
Second.
A motion from Councilman Sherman and a second from Councilman Benson to approve ordinance number 2016-002. Is there any further discussion? The clerk, call the roll, please.
Sherman?
Yes.
Benson?
Yes.
Eckhart?
Yes.
Hannaford?
Yes.
Stelling?
Yes. Now I would ask for a motion to declare an emergency to ordinance number 2016-002.
Make a motion to declare an emergency for ordinance 2016-002.
Do we have a second?
Second.
A motion from Councilman Hannaford and a second from Councilman Sherman to declare an emergency on ordinance number 2016-002. Any further discussion? Would the clerk call the roll, please?
Hannaford?
Yes.
Sherman?
Yes.
Stelling?
Yes.
Eckhart?
Yes.
Valencia?
Yes.
Benson?
Yes.
Item number 11, discussion and action on the placement of an LPG storage tank in excess of 100 gallons within the city limits.
Share Medical Center has presented a letter asking for a variance to place a 12,000-gallon LPG tank at the back of their parking area for as a backup fuel source for their new boilers. The Code of Ordinances allows a person to maintain tanks in excess of 100 gallons of highly flammable only after council has deemed the project would not be unduly hazardous to the public welfare or dangerous to the neighborhood. Any storage facility must meet any requirements set forth in pamphlet 30 issued by the National Fire Protection Association. And I've asked Fire Marshal Brian Miller to come in and kind of explain and let the council know how that is going to affect the area around where it's being placed in the neighborhood.
What is being asked and kind of the reason why? The several meetings with CFO Kevin O'Brien and CEO Candace Allen, the Share Medical Center, what we've kind of talked about. Also spoke with their architect firm, Allen's Consulting out of Norman. Share Medical Center is putting in a new boiler system, and some of the state regulations that they have to abide to is an alternative fuel source that if natural gas or something would go down, they'd have something to back that boiler system up because that's a requirement of the hospital. They shot a proposal within the plans, and I don't know if you guys got a copy of the plans to go along with it. But basically, on the northwest corner of the parking lot behind Share Medical Center, they're requesting to put a 12,000-gallon LPG propane tank down there. It's met all the requirements with the code that I've asked them to do. NFPA 58 sets those requirements as distances away from their liquid oxygen that they have down there. You know, housing that's to the south on South Sunset may be a little bit of concern if we end up having some venting issues for overpressure, and that's a normal operation of that system. But LPG vapors are heavier than air, so they're going to go in that canyon. So that may be something that we want to take into consideration on that also. And also, based off the ordinance too, you guys have the opportunity to determine if you want to allow them to keep it above ground with a barrier protection device, or if you want them to bury. There's several different types of ways that you can do that based off of NFPA 58. If it's not driven over, it only has to be 3 inches below the surface. If it's something that's going to be driven over the top, it's got to be 36 inches below the surface in that. But basically what they've asked for is an above ground system. They've also asked for non-suppression system, and I don't think that's going to be an issue either because it doesn't have vegetation. It's on a non-combustible surface down there in the bottom. All they really have to have is vehicle protection did speak with them, because we have this ordinance within the city limits, storing something over 100 gallons, that they had to submit a letter to the mayor to be brought to you guys for recommendation if you will allow that. I really don't see any other issues other than overpressure and venting and where those vapors are headed.
So do they have to have that big a tank?
That's what the boiler system requires. So that's the reason why they have to have a 12,000 gallon tank.
You mentioned the vapors going down into the canyon. How long do those vapors tend to last? I mean,
It's going to really depend on the weather and the temperature outside. And if it's cooler, it's going to keep them down longer in that canyon. At the lower explosive within that ride next year, and it finds an ignition source, and basically what you're going to have is a vent fire on it. But there's different types of safeties that they can put on that would kill that problem if it came to it. And those are actually drawn specs that they have right now.
Okay. Just with our, so the cooler temperature would be the problem, not during our fire season?
Not during our fire season. When it's hotter out, they have a tendency to evaporate quicker because it's a cryogenic gas. So, -286 degrees. It seems to off gas and get the atmosphere a little bit quicker.
Any sheriff personnel have to have any special certification or licensure to?
They don't have anything to operate on it, but they would have to if they were going to perform maintenance or work on it. So it would be somebody would have to be licensed within that system to basically work on that system. As for the boiler side of it, you'd have to be a licensed boiler operator to work on the boiler. On that alternative.
Being above ground, will they have some type of structure around it then?
Yeah, there's a couple of different ways within this, and we're kind of not to that part yet within the construction design. We're looking at placement first. Once, if accepted by the council and that placement is approved, then we'll get into the next section of how that's going to be put up down there, if it's going to have a retaining wall around it, if it's going to have barrier devices such as like concrete posts and things to protect the vehicles. And they do have a semi that comes down there and offloads. So we want to make sure that that's taken into consideration, that there's enough room that you can operate down below there.
And we're essentially talking about an above ground tank similar to like what Long Gas would have down on their property.
It's going to sit on what's called a concrete saddle. They give different dimensions based on the different types of tanks that you can put down there. This one's going to have impact protection, thermal protection on it. They're going with a really good system that they're putting down there. So I really don't see no issue.
Approximately how big is the outside dimensions of this tank?
You're probably looking close to something like what Long has down there. It's going to be a large structure. It's probably not going to be just as long, but as big as the diameter as it is to get 12,000 gallons on that.
Does the council have any more questions for Mr. Miller? And if not, I would entertain a motion.
So, Brian, you don't see a problem with allowing them to have this tank?
I don't see a problem with it. I do think that the residents that live in the neighborhood behind it, as long as we educate them and let them know the safety factors that are built into it. And some people have already heard about it and have asked questions, and they say what they see in the movies, big catastrophic failures, bombs and caps and stuff like that. But the one thing that we really got going for us is it's non-combustible down there. That's what causes the tank to blubby. It's got to have something that heats that tank to make that catastrophic failure. And we don't have anything close to it. So I think that's where that education part would come in and help.
because they have a boiler system instead of a, some other kind of heating system?
From my understanding, since their normal boiler system runs on natural gas, they have to have an alternative fuel source in case that natural gas source fails for some reason. Based on the state requirements that they have to have heat. So it's either liquid petroleum gas or diesel or a generator system, but the type of boilers that they selected was the natural gas and the LPG system.
On that question, would those tanks have to be fully fueled all the time?
They're not fully fueled. They'll probably be up to 80% capacity is what they'll fuel them to on that, because your cryogenic liquid has to have that vapor space in there, because that's what you're burning. When it calls for gas, it's allowing that vapor or that liquid to turn into a vapor and provide that fuel source. You have to have that kind of vacuum space in there to push that gas into the system.
How often, I mean, we're obviously not going to fill it to 80%, just leave it for the next, until they need it. I mean, how often is that cycled or is that checked?
There's probably, you know, and I'm not really familiar with their system, but I can probably tell you that there's probably either a weekly or a monthly switchover. So they're going to be burning LPG at some point in time for a certain amount of hours to make sure those systems are working. Because if they just sit there and lay dormant and it switches over, they may have some issues. So that helps them catch those issues prior to, if they do have, for some reason, they don't get natural gas and they'll be able to switch it over. They know that it's functioning properly. Any other questions?
Counselor, what kind of motion does this need to be? I mean, just to approve them to put in a tank over 100 gallons, or specifically what we're talking about?
Yeah, I think as presented, since we have the documentation in the packet that you have, so.
Okay, I'll make a motion to allow Share Medical Center to put a LPG storage tank in excess over 100 gallons, following the documentation. So they give us.
Second.
I have a motion by Councilman Benson, second by Councilman Sherman, to permit Share Medical Center to place a LPG storage tank in excess of 100 gallons per the documents presented within the city limits. Is there any further discussion? Please call the vote.
Benson?
Yes.
Sherman?
Yes.
Stelling?
Yes.
Valencia?
Yes.
Eckhart?
Yes.
Hannaford?
Yes.
Now we'll move to earlier. Thank you, Councilman Valencia, for calling the meeting to order and managing it in my absence. And we will now move to item number 6. Discussion and action on the appointment of Mary Hamilton to the Alva City Council to fill the vacancy in Ward 3, Seat 2. As you are all aware, Councilman Miller has moved out of state. His seat had been vacated, and he has, had an opportunity to look at folks that live in Ward 3 and who might be interested and willing and able to serve in that capacity. And I've spoken with Mrs. Hamilton and at a pretty good length, and she is willing and able and interested in serving in this capacity. So therefore, I present to you Mary Hamilton for appointment and would entertain a motion to do so.
Make a motion to approve the appointment of Ms. Mary Hamilton to the Alva City Council to fill the vacancy in Ward 3, Seat 2.
Second.
I have a motion by Dr. Hannaford, second by Councilman Valencia, to approve the appointment of Mary Hamilton to the Alva City Council to fill the vacancy in Ward 3, Seat 2. Is there any further discussion? Please call the vote.
Hannaford?
Yes.
Valencia?
Yes.
Sherman?
Yes.
Benson?
Yes.
Stelling?
Yes.
Eckhart?
Yes.
Okay. Item number 7 is the swearing-in of Mary Hamilton. Mary, would you please come forward? We will swear you in.
You will raise your right hand and take the following oath. Do you solemnly swear or affirm that you support, obey, and defend the Constitution of the United States and the Constitution of the State of Oklahoma, and that you will not knowingly receive directly or indirectly any money or other valuable thing for the performance or non-performance of any act or duty pertaining to your office other than the compensation allowed by law? And do you further swear or affirm you will faithfully discharge your duties as a councilperson for Ward 3, Seat 2 to the best of your ability?
Thank you, Mary.
Thank you.
Please join us. Item 12 is discussion and action to request the refund of the unused fiscal year 2013-2014 loss fund from OMAG in the amount of $13,853.99. Joe Don.
Well, we had, right before the last council meeting, we did receive notice from OMAG that we had a unused balance from our workers' compensation net claims activity from fiscal year 2013-14. That money was placed in an escrow account to be used as the city council saw fit. It could be used in three different ways. One, it can stay in the escrow account and be utilized to reduce next year's workers' compensation premium. The city can take it as a credit against our current year's premium, providing that our premium is greater than $5,000. Or we can, and we are making quarterly payments. Or we could request the amount in lump sum from the in the form of a refund. The finance committee has discussed this, and right now is recommending to city council that we request this as a refund in the amount of $13,853.99. This is money that was not anticipated during the budget process. So if this is approved and once this money is received, there will be a budget adjustment needing to be done to expend these funds. And I'd be happy to answer any questions that you may have.
Does the council have any questions for Mr. Dunham? If not, I would entertain a motion to request this refund.
Motion to request refund from OMAG in the amount of $13,853.99.
Second.
Have a motion by Councilman Sherman, second by Councilman Benson, to request the refund of the unused fiscal year 2013-2014 loss fund from OMAG in the amount of $13,853.99. Is there any further discussion? Please call the vote.
Sherman?
Yes.
Benson?
Yes.
Hamilton?
Yes.
Eckhart?
Yes.
Hannaford?
Yes.
Stelling?
Yes.
Valencia?
Yes.
Next item is discussion and action to authorize a city employee Christmas banquet.
Well, the city of Alva has never, since I have been an employee of the city of Alva, has never had a Christmas banquet. I've had numerous council members, men over the years, ask me why we do not do this. We really don't have a good answer for. I guess at one time there was something that happened. Maybe there just wasn't enough participation or whatever. But they were asked me to kind of check into the costs. Checking into the cost of this, it looks like we would be able to have a citywide employee Christmas party. Catered in with a cost for the employees and their families for about $3,000. We'd be looking at having the, if we were to hold a Christmas banquet, We'd be looking at having it on December 9th at the rec center. Right now, the plan would be to cater in the meal. I think there's been some discussion after the fact, once the agenda was published, that there might be a couple of council members that would be willing to cook instead of cater. It would be listed as a special event, a special meeting for council participation, no business to be discussed, a social event only type of deal. And we can see what, we'd get notification out to employees in their next payroll check, which is, if approved, will be this week, about the Christmas party to allow time for planning. I do think that the cost would be around $3,000. This was not specifically planned for during our budget process. So the way we would end up paying for it, we do have contingency money that we've got. And depending on whether or not we saw this as a one-time event or whether we saw this as a annual event, would depend on how we would pay for this. Either way, ultimately affects the city's contingency account. We're either paying directly from it or we're transferring funds from that line item to another line item to pay for it, whichever would be the most appropriate. With that, I'd answer any questions that the council may have about this.
Do we require our employees to reserve or say they'd be there, how many they'd be there?
We would ask for an RSVP just for planning purposes for the meal, to make sure that we didn't overbuy. We've tried to have some events like this in the past, and we didn't ask for that, and we actually ended up overbuying. So just to kind of control costs, we would ask for an RSVP just for planning purposes.
I know this has been a topic with some of the council members. Have the staff embraced the idea of a Christmas party, or is it?
To my knowledge, they have. We've talked about it in staff meetings. We've talked about it. Staff has worked on it to develop the menus. Up to now, they've embraced the idea of a Christmas party, Christmas banquet.
December 9th, because I believe I'm going to be out of town that evening.
Well, when we chose the date, we looked at the other events
that
were going.
They looked at the dates you would be gone.
We looked at the dates that where there wouldn't be any conflicts around town and when we could get all of our people there, and that seemed to be the most, the date that nobody was doing anything other than you, Councilman.
And because we just took in $13,853, I'll make a motion we approve the city employee Christmas banquet.
Second. Have a motion by Mr. Benson, a second by Dr. Hannaford to authorize a city employee Christmas banquet. Is there any further discussion? Please call the vote.
Benson?
Yes.
Hannaford?
Yes.
Valencia?
Yes.
Stelling?
Yes.
Sherman?
Yes.
Hamilton?
Yes.
Eckhart?
Yes.
And as Jodon mentioned, if there are council members interested in helping to prepare this meal, please get with me and I will help determine if there's enough of us to make it happen, and if so, we'll make plans and all coordinate that for us to do for the city employees. So the next item on the agenda, number 14, is discussion and action on the appointment of Mr. Charles Murrow to the Alva Board of Adjustment for a term ending in June 2018. Position on this board is one that was also vacated by Wes Miller with his move out of town, And I have spoken with Mr. Murrow about this, and as well as the next item, the Planning Commission vacancy, and he is willing and able to fill this position any way he can help. Therefore, I do present to you and recommend the appointment of Mr. Charles Murrow to the Alva Board of Adjustments for a term ending in June 2018.
I'll make a motion to appoint Charles Murrow to the Alva Board of Adjustments, term ending June 2018.
Second.
I have a motion by Mr. Benson, a second by Mr. Sherman, to appoint Charles Murrow to the Alva Board of Adjustment for a term ending June 2018. Is there any further discussion? Please call the vote.
Benson?
Yes.
Sherman?
Yes.
Hamilton?
Yes.
Stelling?
Yes.
Valencia?
Yes.
Eckhart?
Yes.
Hannaford?
Yes.
And I'm not sure in which order this goes, but we are required to have a member of, for going on into item 15, a member of the Board of Adjustments and a member of the Planning Commission needs to be a single person. Wes was serving in that capacity as a member of both, and I've asked Mr. Murrow to serve in that capacity as a member of both. Again, he has expressed an interest in doing so and is willing to serve in that capacity. And therefore, I also recommend the appointment of Charles Murrow to the Planning Commission for a term ending in June 2020.
Make a motion to appoint Charles Murrow to Alva Planning Commission, term ending June 2020.
Second.
I have a motion by Mr. Sherman, a second by Mr. Hamilton, to appoint Charles Murrow to the Alva Planning Commission for a term ending in June 2020. Is there any further discussion? Please call the vote.
Sherman?
Yes.
Hamilton?
Yes.
Benson?
Yes.
Eckhart?
Yes.
Hannaford?
Yes.
Stelling?
Yes.
Valencia?
Yes.
Item 16 is discussion and action on the appointment of Mr. Gerald Benson to an at-large position on the Alva Code of Appeals Board. It was brought to my attention by Mr. Dunham that we had, and Mr. Miller had served on Code of Appeals Board as well, but that the meeting of that body had not occurred in several years, and that with Mr. Miller leaving, it was probably a good idea to make sure that the other remaining members were still interested in serving. This is not a termed position, if I understand correctly, and they serve at the will of the council and the mayor. We'll be required to, as we looked at that, we had an at-large position, a builder position, two at-large positions, I suppose. And I've spoken with Gerald and Mr. and Chris Meyer as well, and I feel like the three of these people represent the Code of Appeal, or the Code Appeals Board is charged with, I guess, allowing any major building variances to for businesses or individuals that may request such variances, but I feel with their backgrounds, both in construction as well as mechanical and plumbing and stuff, as well as Chris's background in fire safety, these three individuals will put to you as separate items on the agenda for those reasons. Spoken with all of them, they are willing to serve, and therefore we'll start with Mr. Benson, Gerald Benson. I recommend his appointment to an at-large position on the Code of Appeals Board. Would entertain a motion to do so.
Motion to appoint Gerald Benson to an at-large position on the Alva Code of Appeals Board.
Second.
There's a motion by Mr. Sherman, second by Dr. Hannaford, to appoint Mr. Gerald Benson to an at-large position on the Alva Code of Appeals Board. Is there any further discussion? Please call the vote.
Sherman?
Yes.
Hannaford?
Yes.
Valencia?
Yes.
Stelling?
Yes.
Hamilton?
Yes.
Eckhart?
Yes.
Benson?
Yes.
Item 17, yes.
I may have missed you say it because I was looking over here. We're getting ready to appoint three people. Do we have some people besides Miller that?
Joel Fogelstrom has asked to be taken off, and then there was a vacancy.
Randy Goucher is listed as the chairman. That would not be appropriate. He's the code enforcement officer, so this board is actually wanting variances against the decisions he may make or Fire Marshal Miller may make.
So actually, he's not going to be on the board anymore?
He will not be on the board at all.
So we're replacing Goucher, Fogelstrom, and Miller?
Yes.
And Mr. Miller and Mr. Goucher will participate, but not as voting members of that authority.
Yeah.
I would entertain a motion to appoint Mr. Egner to the builder position on the Code of Appeals Board.
I'll make the motion to approve Jerry Egner to the position of Code of Appeals Board.
Second.
Have a motion by Mr. Benson, second by Mr. Eckhart, to appoint Jerry Egner to the builder position on the Alva Code of Appeals Board. Is there any further discussion? Please call the vote.
Benson?
Yes.
Eckhart?
Yes.
Hamilton?
Yes.
Hannaford?
Yes.
Sherman?
Yes.
Stelling?
Yes.
Valencia?
Yes.
And item 18 is the appointment of Mr. Chris Meyer to an at-large position on the Alva Code of Appeals Board. And I would entertain a motion.
Make a motion to appoint Mr. Chris Meyer to an at-large position on the Alva Code of Appeals.
Second.
Have a motion by Dr. Hamilton, or Hannaford, second by Ms. Hamilton, to appoint Mr. Chris Meyer to an at-large position on the Alva Code of Appeals Board. Is there any further discussion? Please call the vote.
Hannaford?
Yes.
Hamilton?
Yes.
Valencia?
Yes.
Stelling?
Yes.
Sherman?
Yes.
Eckhart?
Yes.
Benson?
Yes. Does that board now meet to determine the chairperson, or how does that work?
Yes, the chairperson was elected among those members.
Item 19 is remarks and inquiries by citizens. Big group tonight. Marion or Brian, you're welcome to say anything at this time. Item 20 is remarks and inquiries by council members. Council members have any remarks or inquiries?
I would just like to thank Mr. Miller for his assistance earlier in explaining thoroughly everything with the LPG gas tank. Appreciate that.
And I'd just like to say thank you for inviting me and having me. I look forward to working with all of you.
Well, we're glad you're here. So would you like a mayor's report?
If you have something, I don't want to cheat you out of your time.
That's what I said no about.
Going to be a busy week down here tomorrow, or busy day down here tomorrow in two other locations in town, I imagine. And I was involved in a Veterans Day event, delaying me from arriving here on time. So thank you, Mr. Valencia, again for filling in. At that, and if there's no other comments or inquiries, you have my mayor's report. We stand adjourned. And now we will open the Alva Utility Authority meeting. Will the clerk please call the roll?
Benson?
Here.
Eckhart?
Here.
Hannaford?
Here.
Hamilton?
Here.
Sherman?
Here.
Stelling?
Here.
Valencia?
Here.
Item 3 is discussion and action on the consent agenda. All of the following items which concern reports and items of a routine nature normally approved at AUA meetings will be approved by one vote of the authority. Any trustee desiring to discuss an item on the consent agenda may request that it be removed from the consent agenda and placed for discussion as the next item on the regular agenda. It will then be considered separately. The consent agenda consists of the consideration and action on the following items. Item A, approval of the minutes of the regular meeting of October 17, 2016. And item B, approval of claims in the amount of $60,806.49 and payroll expenses of $40,877.26. Is there a motion to approve the consent agenda?
Make a motion to approve the consent agenda.
Second.
Have a motion by Dr. Hannaford, a second by Mr. Sherman to approve the consent agenda. Is there any further discussion? Please call the vote.
Hannaford?
Yes.
Sherman?
Yes.
Valencia?
Yes.
Stelling?
Yes.
Eckhart?
Yes.
Benson?
Yes.
Hamilton?
Yes.
Okay, we'll close the Alva Utility Authority meeting and open the Alva Economic Development Authority meeting. Will the clerk please call the roll?
Benson?
Here.
Eckhart?
Here.
Hannaford?
Here.
Hamilton?
Here.
Sherman?
Here.
Stelling?
Here.
Valencia?
Here.
Item 3 is discussion and action on the consent agenda. All of the following items, which concern reports and items of a routine nature normally approved at AEDA meetings, will be approved by one vote of the board. Any trustee desiring to discuss an item on the consent agenda may request that it be removed from the consent agenda and placed for discussion as the next item on the regular agenda. It will then be considered separately. The consent agenda consists of the consideration and action on the following items. Item A, approval of the minutes of the regular meeting of October 17, 2016. And item B, approval of claims in the amount of $36,309.01 and payroll expenses of $8,381.76. Is there a motion to approve the consent agenda?
Move to approve the consent agenda.
Second.
Have a motion by Mr. Benson, a second by Mrs. Hamilton to approve the consent agenda. Is there any further discussion? Please call the vote.
Benson?
Yes.
Hamilton?
Yes.
Stelling?
Yes.
Eckhart?
Yes.
Hannaford?
Yes.
Sherman?
Yes.
Valencia?
Yes.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. We are adjourned.